And finally tonight, a play about a financial collapse meets its own unexpected end.
Take one massive financial scandal.
I don't mind taking losses. I can't report taking losses right now.
Add a bit of song and dance.
This is structured finance.
And a few dead-eating dinosaurs.
This is how it looks.
And you have Enron the play, which came to Broadway after a hugely successful London run and attempted to go where theater rarely ventures.
Electricity won't be deregulated. Canada's not going to get that kid into the White House.
We will.
Into the dark heart of high finance and corporate corruption, 2001 collapse of Houston-based energy-turned-trading giant Enron.
Doesn't matter if it's a bad deal. Just get the deal done.
The more I read about that, the more I thought, well, why don't I fully understand this? And I tend to get fascinated by things I don't fully understand because I want to kind of work out how it works.
British playwright Lucy Prebble, now 29, was just finishing college when Enron hit the headlines. When we talked just before the show opened, she told me she'd once thought of a career in business herself, but found success in writing for TV and theater.
When you start looking into things like whether it's derivatives or credit default swaps, those things we've been dealing with over the last couple of years, but particularly at Enron, financial instruments generally, you know, well, the more you read about them, the more you think, well, actually what you're dealing with is a sort of metaphor, particularly with derivatives, or even, I'd go so far as to say, a world of illusion. Now, if you're looking at a world of illusion, you're actually quite well placed to represent that on stage, because people come into a theatre expecting to be sold something that isn't real. And that's not a million miles away from how commodities and stocks operate.
And yet you still have to explain to people, you know, mark to market. You
yes.
start their play with,
yes,
with a sort of definition.
Creative and then illegal accounting, of course, was at the heart of what was then the biggest bankruptcy in U.S. history, with company executives in handcuffs and thousands of employees losing their jobs and their life savings. Enron the play revels in its own razzle-dazzle, but the focus is on the real-life characters who became synonymous with greed and corruption. Most of all, CEO Jeffrey Skilling, a man with, at first at least, an honest dream.
We hire the smartest people we can find. We set them free to look at whatever they want. Less routine, less structure, let people's minds work. Free from the old assumptions about what this company is. Don't part with your illusions.
Actor Norbert Leo Butz plays Skilling, whose 24-year sentence on a variety of charges is even now being appealed.
Once you bury a dead dog, you don't dig it up to smell it.
Gregory Itzen, familiar for his role as the president in the TV hit 24, plays a different sort of leader here, Ken Lay, the head of the company who was found guilty of securities fraud but died of heart failure in 2006 before being sentenced.
I find this a very uniquely American story in a way. The greed, the headlong drive towards success, the once you get success, the blinders that come on, and how it's also interesting playing a kid. Well, you're playing a guy who's still alive, and I'm playing a man who has passed on. Supposedly, there are. If you go online, he's somewhere hiding. I mean,
oh, really?
Yeah. But I
along with
not,
Elvis, somewhere. Ken Lay and Elvis are hanging out in a bar somewhere.
Well, what's it like playing these characters that are so? You know, alive in people's, for some people, they're real vivid characters because they were deeply affected personally.
I had no preconceived notions of Jeff Skilling. I did not and I do not see him as a villain, simply by virtue that the playwright is not presenting him as such.
Everything I've ever done in my whole life worth anything was done in a bubble, in a state of extreme hope and trust and stupidity.
The thing we talked about early in rehearsals, and it's very important to remember, yes, he was a bully. Yes, he was an intellectual bully. Yes, he was crude. Yes, he was manipulative. Yes, he lied. However,
that's a litany of stuff right there. Yeah, okay.
He also explained in a very valid argument that all he was doing was taking free markets to their logical extreme.
Maybe so, but now it turns out that Broadway's free and fiercely competitive market has taken down Enron the play. The $4 million production received only tepid reviews here, unlike in London, where it continues to thrive, and U.S. audiences seem to have decided it's not for them. Peter Marks, who reviewed the show for The Washington Post, says something happened when the play crossed the Atlantic.
We're two different political cultures. The way we look at the world actually turns out to be very different. And there is an inherent criticism of American culture. I think we feel somehow that they are judging our system. And we can do our own judging, I think we feel.
Plus, says Marks, there's the inherent difficulty of presenting the news on stage.
I think in this case, this Enron is something we did hear over and over again. We're pretty sophisticated about the topic itself, and you've got to tell us something new. You can't just rehash it for us.
Another possibility, the Enron scandal seems quaint after what's happened in the last 2 years. Whatever the case, the show will close on Sunday after just 15 performances, making it one of Broadway's more expensive flops in a number of years.